join me today at the absolutely beautiful Southfield Reservoir, where we're going to talk about the basics of bream fishing. Now, there's loads of natural venues up and down the country where you can have a really good day's bream fishing, and I know a load of you guys love to go out and do that. Even if you don't, you might find it interesting because we're going to pick up the feeder rod, we're going to look at keeping everything as simple as possible, but hopefully putting loads of bream in the net. Let's go and take a look. So here we are, all set up. And I think it's important to talk about the setup because my setup is actually really simple and quick to do. But when you're fishing on a natural venue, the banks aren't always the nicest. You might have to sit in a little bit of shallow water, something like that. And having the right setup and being comfortable and having everything to hand is huge to your day, in my opinion. I haven't got loads of stuff going on here, but I've just tweaked it over the years to get everything spot on. So I felt it was really important. Got my solid platform that I've put my chest waders on to set up. Just set it level with the water so I'm nice and comfortable. Got my keep net here at the front on my bar right in front of me with a secure rod rest. My landing net's nice and secure. I've just used an extended feeder arm here for my landing net. Always carry two feeder arms just in case I have a drama with the front one. So just tend to set up the spare one at the back and it keeps the landing net out of the water nice and secure, which is nice. Two nice big solid side trays supported with the support arm, so nothing has to go in the water. And then I've got my rig roost here if I need to put another couple of rods or anything like that. So, you know, it took me like 10 minutes to set up. It didn't take me any time whatsoever, which I think's part of enjoying my day. I don't want to make anything too complicated. So I'm going to focus on one line today and we'll talk about that a little bit on the feeding. So I'm just going to show you my bait choices and tackle setup so you can see how straightforward it is before we get onto the feeders and maybe a little bit more intricacies of feeding and that. So first of all, my baits. I've mixed up some salted caramel ground bait here. Really nice ground bait, great for naturals really because it's got a high biscuit content and some crushed pellet. All naturals in the UK for bream. I love a pellet based ground bait. So having that biscuit in there makes it really nice. And I've actually mixed it in two different ways. First of all, I've mixed it really dry. So if I try to squeeze this in a ball there, you can see it just squeezes in a ball, but honestly, just touch it and it'll break down. It's very, very dry. It'll break down quickly. That's if I want to introduce some wet baits like worms and dead maggots and stuff like that. I can do that with this ground bait without ruining it. And then I've mixed up a little bit more. That's just a bit damper. So if I squeeze this in a ball, you can see there it's a lot tackier. Everything's a lot more damp throughout. And this is if I want to introduce some ground bait on its own, it's absolutely perfect. So just basically split my ground bait into two halves. So I've got a couple of options there. Bait wise, in terms of live baits, it couldn't be easier for me. When I'm bream fishing, personally, I'm not a massive fan of taking like loads of casters to my peg. I tend to love worms and I like maggots. Now, at Southfield, that certainly seems to be the case. On other venues, casters might be fantastic. I used to fish Bow Beach, Tamar Reservoir, both places that respond really well to casters. So keeping my worms in the sieve tub, this is actually the prototype that I've been using for about 6 months. They're out in the shops now, nice blue color they come in. But the beauty of these is your worms have got air all around and they tend to clump themselves nicely in the middle. So they don't cook, they don't die, but they keep themselves nice and clean in the middle. So I've been using that to store my worms, you know, while I'm fishing. That's fantastic. I've got my little sieve here for my chop worms. So again, I've been testing this for ages. Everybody asks me about the sieve, but when I'm chopping some worms up, got a sieve where I can put my some worms. And then I've just brought with me some live and dead maggots. Now, all I did was buy a pint of maggots, stick half of them in the freezer overnight so they're dead, and then I kept half live. Because, do you know what? You never know when you're bream fishing. Sometimes a live bait is fantastic. Sometimes you need maybe a bigger dead bait, softer bait, or if you want to feed a few maggots, I like to feed a few dead maggots as well. So you know, having a dead and live option is really important. Not a big bait bill. I bought a kilo of worms. I expect to use about half of them. And then obviously a pint of maggots. So not massively complicated there when it comes to the baits. I don't want to fish miles out. We're going to touch on that in the feeding in a minute. But I've got with me an 11-foot rod. Really straightforward setup. I think if you're going to fish for bream on a natural venue, you're probably leaving your 10-foot rods at home. You're looking at 11 or maybe even 12-foot if you're fishing a bit further. But we're only fishing 30 metres today. So I've got an 11-foot Superior X. It was a toss-up. Didn't know whether to bring my Ascensions with me, the 11-4s. Both would do a great job. But something that when you're on a big water, you can see it's quite windy here today. So I am going to need to sort of punch my feeder to keep nice and accurate. So I don't want anything too soft. Got lovely strength in the bottom, but a lovely action at the top. And I've just got an ounce tip in it. When it comes to choosing the tips in your rod, honestly, it doesn't need to be too complicated. I tend to find an ounce and a half for 10, 11 foot rods, and then 2 ounce for a 12 foot and 3 ounce if I'm fishing a 13 foot. It's really straightforward. So don't get hung up too much on the tips in your rod. Ultimately, if there's some tow on today and my tip's bent right round, it wouldn't matter even if I had a 5 ounce tip in. I'm gonna see a bite because the rod tightens itself up anyway. So don't get carried away with it. It's more about keeping that true into the rod and making sure that the rod works well with the tip you've got. So I've got a 5,000 size reel, or 520 should I say, you know, just an extremity. Talked about these a million times. It's the only reel I'm going to use for natural water fishing. And I've got some 010 absolute feeder braid. Now, if you are a bream angler, personally, I think you should be fishing with braid. I think braid's absolutely fantastic. It means you can be nice and accurate, you can read your bites really well, and you get the full experience when you pick up into a bream. You feel every single kick, you feel it wink its eye or whatever it needs to do, you will feel it because the braid is there to give you all the action. Now, I've put a shock leader on it because we're fishing at Southfield where it's quite shallow. I love a shock leader. Anywhere where I'm fishing for bream, I'll use a shock leader. The bites tend to be really positive, so I like to have that bit of mono there, but having the braid for the rest of it means I can control what's going on. So I've just put some 8 pound sinking feeder mono. I've threaded it up and down the rod, got a couple of turns on the reel, and I've used a 3-turn water knot to fix that shock leader to my braid. So really, really straightforward. Now, down at the bottom end, my rig couldn't be any simpler. I've just left the window feeder on here for an example. So I've got a little link that slides up and down my line, like so, free running. You can fish fixed if you want, or a helicopter rig. Done loads of videos on the different types of rig. You can check them out on the Preston Innovations page. And all I've done there is I've put two of our stops, rubber stops, and I've slid them up the line, 50 centimetres up the line, which at Southfield, you know, all the competitions I fish are 50 centimetre rules. So I've got this nice piece of stiff 8 pound line, and then 014 to a 14 N20 hook. Dead straightforward. All I've brought with me today is my 6-inch hook length box, because if I want to make that any longer or shorter, I can slide these stops up and down the line. And if I'm fishing 30 meters out, I don't have to worry about those two stops sliding on such thick line. So for me, that's the simplest rig you can possibly get. If I was fishing a bit further out, I'd probably loop this line around and create a knot so the stops were against the knot. So if I had to punch it a bit harder, I'd have a knot there to stop it. And then I'd just still have the thick line coming down and I could put my short hook length on as I saw fit. So honestly, super duper straightforward. Got my two rests there. It really is a simple setup. Let's get on the box. Let's look at how we're going to introduce some bait into the peg to get going. So let's look at the initial feed of the peg. So I always like to pick two spots when I'm bream fishing. And I'm going to concentrate on one for you guys today because we're trying to look at almost like the basics of bream fishing, as we've talked about. So in a competition, if I was in a competition here, I would probably start off by fishing as long as I comfortably can, 40, 50, 60 meters, depending on where I felt comfortable on the wind on the day. But where I really want to have my bumper day is at a more comfortable distance, and today I've chosen 30 meters. So I've got to think about how I'm gonna initially kick that peg off. Now, don't wanna go really gung-ho on your short line, but you still wanna be positive, because that's why you would probably have two swims on a day. You'd have a further out swim that you just took it nice and steady, nicked an odd fish. But like I said, I'm not sort of here to show you that today. I'm here to show you that arrival, that nice bream session that you could have on, you know, a comfortable distance such as 30 meters. So the two ground baits that I've spoke about, I've got the dry mix and the damp mix here. If I was gonna feed some ground bait into the peg, I would feed the damp mix. I would put maybe three or four feederfuls in, just ground bait, give a nice smell, bit of attraction, something for the fish to come in and have a look at. And then, as we talked about with the baits, I've got some dead maggots and some chopped worms. And I would put some chopped worms in as well at the start, especially now where it's warming up. You know, we're in the spring, they do want to have some worms, so I almost want to take a bit of a gamble early on this line. A lot of people think, oh, is it worms, is it not? On this short line, it's about making a more positive gamble. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put like probably four feederfuls of just ground bait, and then I'm going to get a nice blob of worms, like twice, put it into the dry ground bait, just give it a little bit of a manipulate with my fingers there, just to sort of almost bind it together. And I'm going to feed two with that worm. So six feederfuls in total. I always start with the ground bait first. So just a neat ground bait to begin with. Like, not, honestly, you can see there, if I just use my thumb, just gently pressing down. And I'm only fishing 30 meters, but I always start with ground bait because there's some error in the cast, if you like. So a couple of casts just to sort of get my eye in. I've got my far bank marker there, nice and smooth out to where I'm fishing. Only 30 meters, little bit of a shake on the tip, and I've got a nice smelly ground bait in my peg. So I'm gonna do that now, sort of four times, and then I'm gonna put those neat worms in. And on the worm ones, I'm really gonna concentrate. So I'll show you what I would do with the worm one now. I'd effectively get that bit of worm, scoop it into the feeder. Again, barely nipped, it's nice and shallow here. If it was a deeper venue, then I'd be going deeper. And I really concentrate now. So I'd have had two or three casts to get my eye in, looking at where I'm casting, smooth cast, out to my mark. Oh, that's bang on. Big shake, and then out again. So we put that little bit of bait. I'm gonna put the rest of these in now. Just gonna show you the feeder that I've used. I always, when I'm bream fishing, there is a place for bait up rods, but I wanna show you a more simplified approach. This is the large hex mesh feeder, and it's got a 20 gram weight on, not a big weight on it. So when I put this like little blob of bait into the peg, effectively, the bait is almost the weight. Now, if it was deeper, or I was fishing further out, I'd be using a heavier weight on a stronger rod. But for today, I'm literally just using the 20 gram because I'm only casting 30 meters. The feed is big, so I could be nice and accurate, right on the money there, shake the bait out again. So just, I don't want, you know, I'm not all for these massive, great feeders, these big feeders that sort of go crashing in and put a load of bait in, unless I feel that it's necessary. On a lot of places, I just like to feel my way in. So, you know, the ground bait ones, you almost like building these little parcels of bait, because as accurate as you think you're gonna be, you're obviously always a little bit rougher than you wanna be. So just by putting that little bit of bait in, you're obviously just attracting fish into the area all the time. So don't need to use big feeders, just these sort of like we call it a large, but you can see there, it's not a massive feeder. It's a very controllable feeder on the rod. Gonna get the rest of these feederfuls in, and then we'll have a look at the fishing. So I've had to put my coat on. It's getting a bit chilly out here. So what we're gonna do is, we've obviously fed the peg to kick it off. Like I said, I would have in a competition, I would have fished maybe 30 minutes, an hour, at a longer distance, tried to nick an odd fish, steady away if you like. So I'm gonna do a little bit of fishing for you now, and we're gonna talk through the types of feeders while we're waiting for the bites and why and when we might use them. I'm gonna start on a small window feeder on this line. Now, obviously when we've talked about window feeders in the past, we've said they're great maybe if you wanna catch a few fish, if you wanna draw some fish in, a little bit of a cloud or a cage can be better. But we've put quite, you know, we've put some bait in there. I'm hoping there's an odd fish there. Now, if there isn't an odd fish there, that's when I'm gonna change and use my, you know, a cage or something like that. And we're gonna look at those feeders now. But I'm gonna start by putting one of the greatest bream baits of all time, two red maggots. Failed on that one. There you go, let's get another one. Two red maggots on the hook. Might even put three on it. It's quite coloured here today. I'm gonna start with two. So two red maggots on my hook. I'm gonna put the tiniest amount of worm in my feeder. Not gonna start with a lot of bait because, again, I've already put some worm in, haven't I? I'm gonna put a couple of dead maggots in as well. Let's put those in. And then just this small window feeder in 20 gram. Now, I'm gonna scoop that into the, I'm in the slightly damper ground bait to start with, and just gently press that in. All right, I don't wanna start off, or I don't wanna fish too positively to start with. We've put that bait there. This is just about seeing if there is any fish in the peg. So chuck that window feeder out. Wind's really got up today, and it's a cold wind. It's an easterly wind here today at Southfield, which is, it really is a cold wind that. So just gotta get my rod rest right. Let's have a little look where he needs to go. Just about there is gonna be perfect, I'm saying. Now what I like to do is put a nice bend in my tip just to straighten all that braid out, like really pulling back on the rod, and then just bring the rod round to almost slack. And then I can just let the, once I'm in a nice comfortable position, if there's any tow now, it'll naturally just tighten up my tip like that. Start my stopwatch. Now, for me, I think you wanna be looking at about 5 minutes in the springtime. I don't see the need for long casts when you're fishing in at this time of year. I think when you're fishing, once it starts to warm up, I think the fish are active, I think they're moving. You know, let's look at this today. It's got a ripple on it. Yes, it's a cold wind, which is why I haven't started with a massive feeder. But I wanna be proactive. I don't just wanna put a great big feeder on when I fish for bream, chuck it out, sit back for 15 minutes and hope that I get a bream. I don't feel like that's the best way to fish. I like to sort of, 5 minute cast is generally what I like to do. You know, don't get me wrong, I will mix it up. The one mistake a lot of people make is they get the stopwatch and they go, I'm doing 3 minute cast today. And they set it on 3 minutes and off they go. I'm doing 7 minute cast today and off they go. The stopwatch is there to actually help you learn. So if I have like 5 or 6 5-minute casts and nothing happens, and I've had like 25 minutes fishing, then my next cast, I'll probably chuck it for 10, 15 minutes because I've had those five sort of more quicker casts, if you like. So you've got to be prepared to work and mix it up as you're going. Now, just while we're waiting for this bite, I wanna show you the range of feeders I've brought today. I've literally got one tub of feeders. You don't need to bring loads of feeders with you. This is all about having a simple, basic day. And first of all, it's the Hex Mesh Rocket. Everything I've, you know, these rocket feeders have changed things for me. Rockets and windows with the weight at the bottom, super accurate casting, you know, really good to hit your spot every time. It's a real favorite for me. And I always bring them in the three sizes they come in. So I've got a small, medium, and a large. Let's just grab a medium. And I bring them in 20, 30, and 40 gram today. If your venue needs 50 gram or 60 gram, then by all means bring them, but I don't. So I've just brought two or three of each one in case I lose one or anything. But I've got different sizes. Now, if I'm casting more regularly, 3 to 5 minutes, then I'm probably gonna be looking at this smaller feeder here. If I'm casting, say, 5 to 7 minutes, I might be looking at this medium-sized feeder. Or if I'm being more patient, I'll probably put the big feeder on, cast it out, and wait with a bit more bait there. Don't get me wrong, I might have 3 minute cast with a big one, but I don't think I'm going to. I just had an indication there while I was talking to you guys. Great sign. So obviously that's the sort of thing that I would look for with these. And then window feeders, I've brought the same, I've brought the large, and then I've got medium and I've got the small with me. I haven't brought any of the XLs with me today because I'm not doing that type of fishing. I'm trying to be busy and I've got them in solid and cage. So again, I've got 20 gram, 30 gram, 45 gram, means I can mix it up in the wind or the conditions. And I can use these feeders in different ways. So I've started on the solid feeder just to see what's there. If we don't get a response in 2 or 3 casts, I'll probably put the cage hex mesh on. Or if we get a couple of indications but nothing happens, I might put a cage window on. You know, I can, that was a nice bite. Probably should have picked up at that while I was talking to you guys, but little indications, mainly with bream, you are waiting for a proper positive pull round, to be fair. But something's had a go at my maggots a couple of times there, so we'll wind it in a minute and have a look. And the only other feeder I've brought with me is some small, or some micro and small, in the solid open-end feeders. Now, I love an open-end feeder. It's quick to load, you can nip it in. It's what you guys probably would consider the more traditional style, breamy type feeder. But I've got to be honest, there's a strong crosswind today. I feel like the bottom-ended feeder is going to be much better for me to load and cast out and be a lot more accurate with. So that's why I would do it. So I'm going to bring this in. It might even be a little fish or something. No. So I've had a couple of taps there, which tells me there is an odd fish in the peg. Now, it might be that they didn't want to have a maggot. It might be that we haven't got a bite. Let's have a little look. So both my maggots are absolutely immaculate, which tells me that those indications on the tip were probably liners. It's only very shallow here, so that's I'm quite excited about that, because obviously there's obviously an odd fish in the peg. What I'm going to do this time is I'm just going to put a little piece of worm on then, if that's the case, because, you know, I will try baits 2 or 3 times, but I'm sort of kind of speeding this up a little bit. And if I was fishing for a big bream, I'd almost fish a whole worm. But these bream in here can be sort of 2 to 4 pound in general. So I'm just gonna start by hooking this through the tip like that. And then I'm just gonna cut it off to give myself a little short piece of worm. Because to start with, I wanna see, you know, maybe there's some small fish in the peg. It's probably about an inch long, that piece of worm. Again, I'm just gonna get a tiny, tiny amount of worm. Honestly, like a fingernail sort of size piece of worm, and I'm just going to nip that in. Told you it's you know, I'm quite chilly here, sat here in the shade with that east wind, so I don't want to go crazy. Nip that in. Let's see if we can get a bite here this time. Again, super accurate, looking at my target. Yeah, really happy with that. Rod down. Just bring my rod round, tighten everything up as much as possible. So I'm really putting a bend in the tip without moving the feeder. So as much as I think I can do without moving the feeder, pop it on the rod rest, like so. I can pick up a little bit of slack line here. I'm gonna bring the rod round so maybe you guys can see what's going on. And there we go, we're settled into position there. That's nice. And we'll wait for another bite. So that's the sort of thing that I would look to do. I would, you know, be quite proactive early on, little couple of indications, see what's going on. And I'm gonna have to mix it up a little bit today, but the basics of what bream fishing is about is almost keeping that little bit of bait going all the time. You know, a lot of people think of bream, they think, yeah, you know, throw in 30 balls and hope for a big shoal to rock up. Unless you're fishing at night, when you might get that big arrival, it tends to be that bream will come in pods of 3, 4, 5 fish, and you might get a little run of fish, and then you'll get another run of fish later on in the day. So by being a little bit more proactive, keep mixing it up, keep trying to attract something in, that's how we're gonna keep bites coming. So let's see if I can catch a couple, and then we'll talk about what we're gonna do to, or what we might need to do to keep fish coming or finding some few extra fish. Nothing can resist two fluoro salt. So we're on the third chuck and we've got our first bream of the day, which is great. So obviously it was about 40 minutes I waited, you know, before I went on this line, and we are 3 minutes into the third chuck. I put double maggot back on, just fancied that that maggot would be better. It's just swimming towards me now, just a nice steady wind while you've got a bream on. It looked like a good fish. It came on the surface pretty quickly and it's given me a few nice big kicks. Brilliant bream fishing, isn't it? So you can see my rod there is working brilliant, the old Superior X. Nice smooth action all the way through to the cushioning these big lunges. That's a nice fish. I've had a couple of indications. I do feel like there is some fish here. So we could be in for a real red letter day today, but look, you can just see there, the two maggots in his mouth. Here we go. He's a good un. He is a good un. I'll tell you what. He could be 4 or 5 pound. Look at that. That's an immaculate, look at his fins and his tail. They're in such good condition. His mouth is immaculate. I love to see that. I love to see fishing in great condition like that. He is a beautiful fish. What a lovely fish. Let's hold him up nicely for you guys. Look at that. I'm expecting a few today because it is that time of year when they can come up. Look at that. That's what bream fishing is all about. I'm gonna stick with that tactic for a minute. Let's chuck back out with you guys here. You never know, and we'll see if we can get another one. So I just went with two of the fluoro maggots. I just said to the cameraman while I was waiting, I was getting a few indications and I almost felt like the water's really coloured and the fish weren't actually seeing my bait. So I'm just gonna pop the two fluoro maggots on there. Still got a little bit of mush. I don't even know if I wanna feed any worm, I've gotta be honest. It feels like there's lots of fish there, and you know, I wasn't catching them dead quick, so I've put almost nothing in there this time. Just pressed in a little bit of ground bait, same again. You know, that's why the window feeder can be good. You're just trying, I'm just trying to tighten it up for now because I have been getting indications and I feel like the fish are there. I'm glad I caught one that, you know, third chuck. That's a nice start. But I have felt like the fish were there on my bait, which is great. That ground bait has got, it's got a lot of biscuit in it, that ground bait. And that biscuit and pellet, you can actually see it in there, the biscuit. I feel like it's a lot of food. Look at that, a liner straight away. There is some fish there. I don't think I've been to Southfield where I've had really as indications, I've got to be honest. Usually you don't get many indications and then you might get an odd fish, but clearly it's that time of the year where you could have a mega day. So my point is, I don't know if I need to feed loads of worms or anything like that, because my ground bait's got a lovely food content in it. You know, it's got all those flavors in it that makes it something the fish can actually eat. So I don't think I need to go crazy with the bait. Let's just see if we can get another one on those two fluoros. But I might have to start putting bigger bits of worm on. I mean, when I look at a bream like that, I think to myself, it doesn't get caught very often. It looked like quite a fresh fish, if you like. So, you know, they're gonna be quite inquisitive. Maybe in this color, maybe I need 3 or 4 maggots on the hook, maybe half a dendrobina, something like that. You know, very traditional breamy type baits. You know, we're not fishing for small skimmers. We are fishing for bream, but again, you don't want to give it too long. I feel like, you know, I've only got that small feeder on, and every time I've cast in, I've had almost like an indication quite quickly. But I won't hesitate to put that little cage on. I might do that next chuck actually, just to see. Yeah, I feel like the fish are there at the moment, so Might just put that little hex mesh rocket on, because I feel like the fish are coming in straight away. And I probably just need ground bait. I probably don't need, you know, really any worm at all. I just need something to almost say, look, here we are, lads, and here's my hook bait, because we fed those two nice feeder fools at the start with the worm. We can mix it up as we go along, though. So I think one of the things that I really like to do when I'm fishing like this is always sort of make a few changes. I've been guilty in the past, and so, as we all are as anglers, of being quite static. This is my feeder for bream, and this is what I'm going to cast out, and this is how I'm going to fish. I fishing has evolved a little bit from that. So, you know, I've only got two or three different styles of feeder with me, but I'm never scared to try one to see if it'll have a response. There we go. Oh, that's a liner again. Can't believe it. I can't believe how many liners I've had. Absolutely crazy. So they're obviously not quite settled there just yet. Maybe that, you know, like I said before, next chuck I'm gonna use this cage, and I'm gonna put just ground bait in it. I'm not gonna put anything, any other food in. And we'll see if that gets a fish, because very, you know, it's typical bream fishing where a few bream have come in. They're just not quite settled yet. I think we could have a golden period if they really settle down. So let's give that a chance to happen and see where we go from there. So a change to the cage has worked. I've just feel like the fishing's really good. I can't really give you the, I've done this that to bring them back. There's plenty of fish in the peg. You know, they're clearly loving what I've done, but I've just cut out the worms. Look at the size of these fish. There's loads of fish here, you know. I'm getting odd liners, and I don't think I can remember a day's fishing like this. I think this is number four, probably the biggest yet. That is probably my biggest ever Southfield bream. What a fish that is. I cannot believe the day's fishing I'm having here at the moment. Get him out of the landing net. Look at that. What an absolutely cracking fish. He is 5 pounds for definite. Really nice fish. Three red maggots. There he is. Going to get my disgorger on that 14. And just I'm on a little run now with that feeder. I'm going to just pop him in here. Not going to keep many today, I'm just going to keep a few. When I'm bream fishing, you can imagine when they go back into the peg, they can spook. So, you know, we are allowed to put a few in today, but I'll only put five or six in, I think. Big fish they are. That is a big bream, just looking at him there. Wow, what a beautiful fish. So I'm going to show you, I think, what the difference is. There's a good wind on, the fish are feeding. So three red maggots, that's a big bait, live maggots. I want something they can pick out quickly. I've got a 14 on. I want something that the fish can hook themselves on quickly. I haven't put any worm in for the last three casts. I've literally just been using the ground bait on its own, which, you know, it doesn't get any more basic than that, but I've got it in the cage. And that does seem to be better than the window. So just popping that in there, the small hex mesh caged rocket feeder in there. It's a strong wind now, so I'm picking my mark very slightly to the side so it can come round with the wind. That is right on the money. That was right on the money, that one. Just keep my rod down to sink my braid, and then not moving the feeder, but just tightening everything up. I really do feel like I could be in for my best ever day at Southfield. I've got to be honest, you know, the fish are so big, and I've had some great days here. I've had three or four 50 pound plus catches, but you know, this could be an amazing day because there is a lot of fish there, and it's so simple. It's such a simple operation. And you know, as the day goes on, I can introduce some bait. So let's talk about that. Let's talk about what the moves are. You know, I'm sure I'm just going to enjoy some good fishing here, but you know, as the day warms up, maybe I could introduce a bit more worm. They obviously came to that worm to start with that we baited up with at 30 meters. You know, they have come into that worm, but has it been that when I started off fishing, there was a bit too much bait there and they were just milling around and it's all colored? I think that by going with the just ground bait route, I'm almost just catching them at the moment. And like I said, there's plenty of food in that ground bait. But if I wanted to make something happen, I could put on a slightly bigger cage, have two or three quick chucks. That would be a great option. I could have a chuck with, you know, lots of worm, almost like say, right, I'm gonna put a worm bomb in. I'm gonna fill my feeder full of worm and I'm gonna have one cast just to almost try and make something happen again, because they clearly wanna come into that bait. So whenever you go bream fishing, use those tools at your disposal, you know, use the, that's just with worms, you know, if like I said, where you go, casters might be good or sweet corn might be good. You can use those baits to settle the bream down. But, you know, the way I'm going on here, you know, we've probably got 17, 18 pound already. And, you know, for my session, it's nice and early. And I know that I won't need to do much, hopefully, to keep these fish coming. So it just goes to sort of throw out the window all the old style, you need to pile it in for bream. I haven't had an indication this time, which is interesting because, you know, in my sort of 8 or 9 chucks that I've had for my fish, I've had an indication every cast. So this next cast, what I'll do is I'll put a tiny bit of worm back in, because obviously they've backed off maybe from catching that one. You know, I've nicked 4 out of the shoal now. So, you know, you can imagine they might just back off a little bit. So a little bit of worm to draw them back in could be great. That's what's so great about feeder fishing on these venues. You never know what's going to happen. It's going to bring that in. Let's have a chuck with the worm. Let's see if we can get another couple of final fish for you on the camera. I'm going to keep the maggots on. But you can see there, I could tell there wasn't one in the peg. Look, bait's completely untouched. So little bit of worm in this chuck. You know, only like a thumbnail full, but a bit of different flavor. They'll definitely be able to, you know, you can imagine they must be able to smell it miles away, those bream, because they do come from a long way away to come and get it. That one actually just poor cast, actually. Very meter or so to the left. Not that it matters when you're bream fishing. I think those bream move about all the time, but let's see what a difference a little bit of worm makes. You know, when you're out on these big venues, you can imagine there's so much water in front of me. It's such a vast area of water. And to have the bream there like that, there must be so many in here. So I'll probably make it 2 casts with worms just to put a little bit of bait. I've sort of had, like I say, 5 casts now, I reckon, without it, just the ground bait. And I know that they like it and I know that they'll eat it. But then just maybe a little bit, that means that when you put some worms in, you can probably make something happen. So let's see what impact this worm has over the next 10, 15 minutes. And hopefully you'll join me for a final few fish. So it's just quieting down a little bit. I had probably like an hour where I caught one. I'm cold. It's a cold day. I know it looks sunny, but the wind is from the east and it's really having an effect, I think, on the fish. I thought I was going to be on for a massive wait, but I've just put the little window feeder back on and I put a single maggot on. I put a 16 on, changed down to a 16. put a single maggot on, and I've got one first chuck on that window feeder there. Now, I'm really happy about that. I think that he's an old warrior. Oh dear, he is an old warrior. I think that these fish they came into the swim, and you know, I had a lot of indications early doors. I didn't expect loads of indications. That was the thing. I thought that, you know, usually when I'm fishing for bream, you especially here at Southfield, you might get an odd indication, but then you, then what seems to happen is the fish tend to sort of settle down, and you'll be waiting and you'll just get a bite out of the blue. But it seems like I've had to go a little bit steadier. You know, I've had to put a smaller hook on, put my smaller feeder back on, put that thumbnail piece of worm in, and there, 4 minutes on the clock, and I've got one there. So I've got about six now, so that's great. And I think it's going to be a case of doing the things that I've shown you today, doing the things that we've spoken about to keep fish coming. Like I said, this wind is cold. It's a cold wind. And I think if it had been a warmer wind, I could have started feeding more worm and caught a lot more fish. But it's been a really interesting day. I hope you've enjoyed how to see the basics of bream fishing on an actual venue, because, you know, even on a day that's had a few testing conditions, we've managed to catch the fish. And I think if you get out on the venues near you, you could have a great day catching some bream this spring.